So will you please join me in welcoming Sultan Saood Al Qassemi? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shimon. It's good to be back here. I have a star panel here with me to talk about an issue that is very personal to most of us in the Gulf, which are the ties between the Gulf and the subcontinent. Even before India was an independent country, the Gulf states and the Arabian Peninsula shared very important historical, cultural, and commercial ties dating back to ancient times. There are today over 7 million Indians who live and work in the Gulf. India today imports 80% of its oil from the Gulf states, and although this number includes Iran, the vast majority of this is from the GCC itself. Until 2014, India was Dubai's largest trading partner when it was overtaken by Shanghai. So we might have a panel next year, Mumbai to Shanghai or Shanghai to Dubai. And finally, hardworking Indians working in the Gulf send back $36 billion a year. 2015, 2016, $36 billion a year. But we will be talking about an issue that is seldom raised in public forums. So this is going to be just between us. We're going to be talking about cultural ties, commercial ties, and what my esteemed panelist, Neha Vora, calls the original free zone, which is gold smuggling, between the Gulf and India. So in the 1960s, the Indian government heavily taxed gold. They limited and almost barred its import. They introduced an act called the Gold Control Act in the 1960s, which restricted the ownership of gold. And it was almost impossible to buy and sell gold within India, as it was so controlled by the government. On a personal note, my mother, in preparation for this panel, would tell me stories about gold smuggling in the 60s and 70s. She would tell me that when girls would leave the Gulf and go to India, they would dress them up in so much gold to say this is their wedding dress. So they're not importing the gold to sell it, but they were just, you know, wearing it for their wedding. One Sharjah-based smuggler was caught, beaten up, and jailed in India, and he's quite a famous businessman. I won't say his name. And another couple of banks that were founded in the UAE, one of them merged, not this year, 3 years ago, so you guys don't get any ideas. That bank was basically built on money that was created through gold smuggling. The penalty that you had to pay was apparently 20,000 rupees if you had been caught smuggling gold. They used to smuggle gold in coal shipments, in tires. And when the Indian authorities would try to board the ships, they would drop them on the edges, on the sides of the boats or the ships. And when the Indian authorities disembark, they go back and they pull the gold up again. So so it was a thriving business. Nobody will admit that their family members took part in this, although I can tell you my grandfather was part of this gold smuggling, but he's passed away since, and I can say that and not get into too much trouble. In fact, my own family's ties with India extend even further, where my great-grandmother was in India in the 1940s and 50s. In fact, my own father, not sure if we have a picture up that I can show you, my own father went to India, that's him on the left, and my uncle, that's a studio in Bombay in the 1940s when they left here on board one of the ships. And they were so poor that you see these two jackets and these shirts were from the studio itself, that in 1945, 46 in India, and the flowers, of course, were not theirs, and and the book probably wasn't even theirs. But they used to dress up. There was a thriving Arab community in India, just like there is a thriving Indian community here in the Gulf. Enough about me. I have an incredible panel, honestly a dream panel, that will tell us about the trade connections between India and the Gulf, the formal, informal, cultural exchanges. I have here on my immediate left Neha Vora, who is an anthropologist whose research focuses on citizenship, migration, diaspora, and check this word out, Indian Ocean circulations. Isn't that an amazing phrase? And you know, she's a very respected scholar. Her first book, Impossible Citizens, Dubai's Indian Diaspora, was published in 2013. We have over there, by the way, we're all wearing vests by coincidence. Huh? It wasn't a plan. We have over there, on your right, Professor James Onley, who is a specialist in history, heritage, culture, society of the Gulf, and historical connections to India. He's the author of The Arabian Frontier of the British Raj. We'll talk about the British connection to all this as well as the founding editor of the Journal of Arabian Studies, where he is also his colleague, Dr. Janardhan, is the assistant editor of the Journal of Arabian Studies. Dr. Janardhan is an advisor to a lot of important people here in the Gulf. He is an Indian political analyst based in the UAE since 2000, and whose publications include A New Gulf Security Architecture, Prospects and Challenges for Asia. So let's start, Professor Janardhan, Dr. Janardhan, with the relationship between India and the UAE. What are the characteristics of the present relationship between India? We talked about the background, the smuggling, the historical ties, but what are the current characteristics of this? And what is the strategic relationship between Dubai and India, or the UAE and India?
I suppose if you look away from smuggling and gold, the relations between the two countries prospered essentially because of oil trade and expatriates. I suppose that's what were the pillars of the India-UAE relationship. What has happened in the recent past, over the last decade or so, is that it has moved beyond those three dynamics. It has moved towards a strategic relationship where security dynamics are coming into play. I think that's essentially a very forward-looking one. We've had a principle of, trade just ruling the roost. It was essentially people to people, P2P, or B2B, which is business to business. But now it's moved to G2G, which is government to government. We didn't have the governments doing too much because trade and oil and people actually took over the relationship. But now with the governments coming into play, we do have ample scope for a strategic engagement where security dynamics come into play. And that's what we will be looking into, because essentially when we had the Crown Prince of Abu Dhabi visit UAE and visit India in January 2017, they have signed a comprehensive strategic partnership, which would entail a host of issues dealing with the security dynamics of the Gulf, which basically comes into play because of the changing security scenario in the region and the slow disengagement of the American naval presence in the region.
So you're telling me that the security dimension is a recent introduction to this relationship. What year are we looking at? What happened for there to be a security dimension?
I think if you really want to place a year, perhaps 2001 would be ideal, 9/11.
Okay.
A lot of it had to do with the kind of balance that existed between the GCC countries and the West, which began to shake up a bit because of the events of 9/11. It was also because there was the simultaneous or the growth of the Asian economies at the same time. So the GCC countries began to look towards Asia for their economic engagement. Investments meant that they had to be protected in one form or the other, and which naturally brought the security dynamics into play as well.
Okay. Neha, I think what was mentioned just now, a very interesting point about how the relationship between India and the UAE, maybe even the greater Gulf area, was based on P2P, person to person, is that what you said, or even B2B? And you also talk about the Indian business community here, that we're living working in the UAE. How important is this community to this relationship between India and the Gulf?
So, as an anthropologist, I talk to and access the historical through people who are living today. So, I'll speak to the memories and the way that they talk about that, and then I'm sure James can probably fill in the more accurate historical details. But you know, with the British colonial presence here in the Gulf, Indian merchants were protected. They had diplomatic immunity. They had special trade relationships, and they had a particular kind of role in which they were middlemen, right, between the trade that happened around the Indian Ocean. And those economic and cultural links to South Asia got really cemented at the time. And India, as you said, even in your introduction, was the cosmopolitan center for the Gulf elites to go to before the West was. That relationship has kind of changed since then. And they controlled the trade centers. When we talk about the free zone aspect,
the original free zone.
So, especially with something like gold, and it wasn't just gold, but the Gulf leaders, when you know, after Indian independence and after and moving towards Gulf independence as well, there were. You know, special relationships where there was low taxation, mm-hmm. where gold in particular, because India was restricting imports of gold into the country, it was not pegged to the global market. Mm-hmm. So the price of gold was extremely high in India. Mm-hmm. So I would do the same thing. My family would do the same thing. Going back to India, we would get loaded up with bangles, you know. And
you would wear them.
Wear them, those like really simple bangles. We'd buy them in Jackson Heights, Queens, and then we'd go and either get them made into jewelry or sell them, right? Or give them as gifts to family members. So on this side, on the Gulf side, it wasn't technically smuggling. It was a special relationship with Sheikh Rashid, where Sheikh Rashid made a lot of money in these relationships with Indian business leaders, Indian merchants. Indian merchants made a lot of money. It's only become smuggling when people cross over into Indian waters, right? So that cements a particular kind of monopoly for Indian businessmen in not just gold, but other sectors as well, textiles, electronics. If you go down into the old souk area, you'll see that those kinds of sectors are still run by Indian businesses, and not Indian, at that time, India included Pakistan,
subcontinent
as well,
basically.
The subcontinent. Yes. Yeah. So many of these folks found themselves nationalized into India and Pakistan while they were living here.
I think what you said was that they're merchants here, but they're smugglers in the subcontinent. Yes. But here they're legitimate because yes. they're not breaking any rules in the Gulf.
Yes.
Okay. James, I'd like you to give us a bit of a historical context. So we have shared history between the Gulf and India. Part of this history is the British presence. So I'd like you to give us a little bit of historical context in how the British operated. Did the British look at the Gulf and India as two separate regions? Did they administer us as one region? Can you comment on that, basically?
Is
his mic on?
Is my con now?
Yeah.
No?
Maybe we can.
Now it's on. Okay.
Now it's on? Okay.
Let me just take you back a bit here to a few pictures. Does this work? No?
Which color?
It's not working.
Can you go back a few slides? Which slide do you want?
Go back to the maps.
The map slide, please.
One of the maps. Map before that, perhaps. Or that map would be fine, I guess. This is a good map, okay. So this map helps explain a lot. Today, when you're looking at maps of the Gulf region, it'll show the Gulf in context of the Middle East. And there'll be a dividing line right along where you see Balochistan, and that's the end of the map. And you don't see or realize how close India is. And this is because we now, in our area studies sort of mindsets, think that the Gulf is in the Middle East. And we think somehow it's hermetically sealed from the rest of the world. When in reality, up until the 1950s, we were not in the Middle East, really. We were in the Indian Ocean, in cultural terms, economic terms, and even political terms. And up until 1947, we would have been sitting now in the Indian Empire. Dubai was a part of Britain's Indian Empire. And I'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. But why was Britain here in the first place? They were here, again, because of this map. India was always has been an economic powerhouse. And the Gulf region has been relatively poor before oil in the local necessities of life. So everything had to be imported. Now, if you go back in time, let's say 5,000 years, and you look at the major centers of civilization at that time, the two major centers in this region were the Mesopotamia and the Indus Valley. The Gulf is right in the middle. So from the very beginning, as soon as ships were invented, we had trade going through the Gulf. This is where globalization began, in the Gulf. This is the oldest part of the global world. People don't realize that, but this is where it all began. And so the populations along the shores of the Gulf quickly got involved in transshipment. And it's always been a cornerstone of business, before oil, of course, and even now. Now, this trade was rather significant. You saw another map of Indian population centers. Of course, there's been an Indian presence here in Dubai for a very long time. But how old is this Indian presence? Well, the earliest, oldest recorded Indian community in the Gulf region is from 2,500 BC. Wow. They were from Sindh and they settled in southern Iraq. So when you look at India, we look at Iran, Iran's part of the Gulf region. India should also be considered a part of the Gulf region, at least Western India. I mean, the Gujarat, Bombay, and of course, what is now Pakistan, southern Pakistan, Sindh, are as much an integral part, historically, economically, socially, even genetically, a part of the Gulf region as Iran, as Iraq. But we don't think of that anymore because of area studies and because of the maps I've told you about and so on. Now, why did Britain become involved in the region? Well, Britain became involved in India. And it became involved not as an imperial power, but as a commercial power, the East India Company. And so they just followed the trade routes. They set up East India Company factories all over the place, wherever the trade was going. Well, the trade link between India and the Gulf region predated Britain by thousands of years. Like I said, going back to at least 2,500 BC. So Britain began to trade from the very beginning of the East India Company. They began to trade through the Gulf region. Then as Britain, the East India Company, morphed into the Raj, the British India, and its protectorates and protected states, those independent states surrounding British India that subsequently were placed under British or British Indian protection, under the protection of British India, this developed into something called the British Indian Empire. Now, Britain's position in the Gulf region transformed in the same way. So just as merchants became colonial officials in India, so did the East India Company representatives here, the agents here, become imperial officials. And the imperial presence really dates from 1820, when the East India Company started to become involved very heavily militarily and launching a devastating sort of Pearl Harbor raid on the UAE, on Sharjah and Ras Al Khaimah, in the winter of 1819, 1820, and then imposed on the Emirates a treaty called the Treaty of General Treaty of Peace. British imperial presence dates from that time, and over generations, Britain became more and more involved in the affairs of the Gulf region by signing more and more treaties with the rulers, initially to stop maritime warfare, something called the Maritime Truce of 1835, which was signed with the rulers here of the UAE, which is why the UAE in the English-speaking world was known before independence as the Trucial Coast, from these truces that were signed in 1835 and then renewed every year. Now, all of this was happening from British India. Why were they doing this? Because of the trade route. So trade is really at the center of everything. The trade needed to be protected, and the continuous maritime warfare going on in the region was upsetting this trade. So Britain imposed this maritime truce. It was actually not so much an imposition as a collaborative arrangement, because everybody had an interest in maritime warfare stopping. It was greatly upsetting for the local economies, especially the pearl fisheries. And Britain stayed on. They stayed on here until 1971. But up until 1947, Britain's affairs and with the region were handled through the government of India. So the predecessors of the British ambassadors in the UAE, Oman, and the other Gulf states were from the government of India, from the Foreign Department of the government of India. And we saw some pictures here of some of those officials. If we go back, I think a few slides, perhaps. Maybe one back more, one, yeah, this one here. This is Bahrain, 1929. In the middle is the British political agent, as he was then known, now today be the British ambassador in Bahrain. To his right, our left, is his deputy, who's the assistant political agent. Obviously not only a member of the Indian Foreign Department, but also Indian himself. And many of the people in the front row here are Indian as well. They were all from the government of India. The second row back and the third row back, all of these were employees of the government of India, but they were recruited either from India or from the Gulf region themselves. So here we have Indians, we have Arabs, and we have Iranians, and we have one Briton in the middle. And this was the norm. This was actually this is representative of the British Indian Empire. It was very multicultural, very cosmopolitan, very global. Until 1947. After 1947, India becomes independent. Britain's relations with the region are transferred to London, to the Foreign Department, which continues to protect the region until independence in 1971. Now, simultaneous with this, we have oil. And why didn't Britain pull out of the Gulf region after Indian independence? There was no reason to stay on in the region except the oil. So Britain did stay on. Because of the oil, all the Gulf governments slowly began to shift their gaze from the east, from India and the Indian Ocean, towards the rest of the Arab world, because a number of other things are going on aside from oil. We have the Arab nationalist movement in particular. We have the invention of the transistor radio, Voice of the Arabs from Cairo. We have Egyptian popular culture. We have flights now, affordable flights. You can fly from here to the rest of the Arab world. So now Eastern Arabia is becoming connected increasingly with the Arab world that it had been separated from in real terms for hundreds of years. It was much easier to sail from Dubai to Mumbai before the age of air than it was to sail or walk or anything to anywhere else in the Arab world, aside from the immediate Gulf region. And so the connections with India and the Indian Ocean were much stronger. They became weaker, and the connections with the Arab world are stronger. And we now think that this is the norm, when in reality, the connections with Asia historically have been the Gulf region's normal sort of trading block. So the Gulf looks east policy, which is or the GCC look east policy, which has been introduced the last 5 years, is actually a return to how things used to be. It's going back to how things had been for thousands of years.
Thank you, James. That's super interesting. Yeah. I'm going to come back to you, Dr. Janardhan, in a minute, but I wanted to ask, this is an interesting gap that occurred when the British withdrew in 1948 from
India?
From India,
47.
And then 47, and then in 1971 from the UAE, and the early 70s from the Gulf, there was a Indian community ties, what you called, I think, P2P, person to person, that really kept the relationship, Neha, between the two countries or the two regions. How important and how substantive is this community here? What are the cultural ties that kept us and India sort of close together?
Well, even though the British, even though India gained independence and the British were no longer administering the Gulf through the British Raj government, the currency that was here was still a rupee. Even to this day, if you talk to older Emiratis, they will still refer to, instead of dirhams and fils, they'll still call them rupees and paisa.
We still call it the dirham rupiah. I don't know about the younger ones, but when we were in school, we say, عندك ربية? Do you have a rupiah that I can borrow?
I remember this very interesting moment from my field work where I had to actually go, because I'm an American citizen, so I need a visa to go to India. And I was in the Indian consulate in Dubai to go and get my visa. And I would watch all of these Indians go up to all the NRI Indians go to...
NRI is?
Non-resident Indian. It's a term actually for people who are Indian citizens who live in the Gulf. But in fact, they use it to talk about people like me who are citizens elsewhere.
But you are a POI.
I'm not a POI. I'm an ABCD.
Oh.
That's a whole other thing. So... all of us would be going up there to to speak to the people at the counter, and we'd be speaking in English, and I'd see all these older Emiratis coming in, and they'd be speaking in Pakka Hindi, right? So it was this bizarre kind of like reversal. And I've had moments where I've been, you know, in a situation where I don't speak Arabic and I haven't been able to, and the Emirati doesn't speak English and I don't know how to communicate. And then all of a sudden I'm like, oh, let me just try some Hindi. And you know, like there's a linguistic connection that it runs really deep, especially among, you know, people who are more rural, people who are older, people who are, you know, not as elite. Those cultural ties are there. The food connections are very evident.
Because we sort of appropriated Indian food here in the Gulf.
We
say biryani is our food.
We all eat biryani.
Who thinks biryani is a Marathi dish?
Yeah. and even the kinds of the tastes we have, and the kinds of if you look at Omani headdress, for example, it's made out of Kashmiri shawls, right?
Yeah. So the wedding ceremonies as well.
Yeah, and so like there's a lot of the wood, the teak wood that that is used around the Gulf in the traditional homes. I mean, those are all, we can see the globalization that James...
Because we don't have teak trees here in the Gulf.
Yeah, exactly. So we can see how these things circulate. So those cultural ties ties and also the economic ties, they remained not only through 1971, but beyond. And then when oil happened and the shift of economic power changed, Indian businessmen capitalized on those connections and have now become the middleman broker for migration, right? And I think that's really interesting to kind of think about how they have utilized their connections in the community and their connections to the Emirates to be part of quite an exploitative system, mm-hmm. Of migration, and part of the things that I look at in my research is that we always have this, you know, perception that it's, oh, Emiratis are doing the exploiting and the Indian migrants are the ones that are exploited. But in fact, in order to have these circulations, we need Indians, right? We need the middlemen, and the same kinds of merchant communities that were participating and having those networks have now reformulated those networks to participate in other kinds of trade.
Okay, I have so many questions to ask you, but I remember my father telling me a story about how once there was an Indian individual here who had a pet, and a person from the UAE had killed this pet, and the punishment to this person who was from the UAE, there wasn't an Emirati because there was no UAE then, was that he had to take two or three rifles and throw them into the Gulf. This was a punishment to punish the person for killing a dog that belonged to a British subject. To a British subject, I should say, in parentheses. But what happened with the Indian communities that were suddenly, I don't know, abandoned? One day they were Indian, they were British subjects, and the next day, between 1947 and the 70s, they belonged to several new entities. They're no longer Indian. They're also Pakistani. They're Indian citizens. Anthropologically, how did this relationship change between people from the Gulf and Indians? Because in one hand, these Indians were at one point, associated with the British presence, and then suddenly they become their own, their own citizens, and then there's many more of them, and then, as you said, this led ultimately to an exploitative system. So I'm so interested in this aspect. I know I just threw this question at you. We haven't planned it, but I'm just curious about this aspect.
Okay, so I'm going to dig back because it's been a long time since I wrote this book. There's a very kind of fuzzy zone here in between when when the Gulf states become independent, right?
47 to 71.
Yes, exactly. And what's already happening in the 20s and 30s is merchant and is political agitation among Emiratis against merchant communities and elites, and some of those are also Indians, right? And there's a sense that there's an exploitative system. It's not just the British; it's also the foreign presence. So that strand has always been in there, but at the same time, there were preferential relationships between Gulf rulers and merchant communities. So, for example, some of the land in Bur Dubai was gifted to the Indian community. So if you look at the Hindu temple, for example, that...
Which dates back almost 110 years or so.
I'm not sure how
far back
it goes.
The one in Dera?
Yeah. That is in Bardubai.
1890s.
That's been gifted to the Indian community, yeah. Right? And some of the business laws that we have here now, where you have to have a 51% Emirati partner, there are people that do not fall under those laws because they had special relationships prior to when those laws went into effect.
So they're Indian citizens who have exceptions to this law?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then all a whole set of loopholes because they also have wasta.
Okay.
Right?
What's wasta?
Wasta is special connections.
Never heard.
You never heard this term? No, never. So there is like this whole kind of group of folks that within that middle space had connections, had special relationships, and then what we see as these very restrictive citizenship rules today, it took a very long time for them to cement into very restrictive citizenship rules, because when these countries first became independent, they needed citizens. So the kind of sense of like blood purity and all of that kind of stuff that we see now, that was really fuzzy at the very beginning. Mm-hmm. They were coming up with the parameters of what citizenship meant slowly and in increments. So some Baluchis got citizenship, some Yemenis got citizenship, Manumin and slaves got citizenship.
Any Indians got citizenship?
Some Indians got citizenship, especially in Oman. There's a whole Indian community that has citizenship. So,
did they want the citizenship, or were these countries in the Gulf, these young fledgling states that you're not sure what their future is, and the Indians sort of come from this great nation that dates back thousands of years. Did they want Gulf citizenship, or did they say we're happy, we're content to be living there as Indians?
In the Emirates, when I was doing my research in Dubai, I never met somebody who had citizenship. There definitely are like the Jashan Mal family and other families. But if you think about it, there is no actual nationalism if you've been living here for so many years and the nation happens while you're already in diaspora, right? Mm-hmm. So that idea of the great Indian nation, the nation state doesn't exist.
Yeah.
You're watching it develop from the outside.
You leave the subcontinent in the 1930s or 40s, come to the Gulf as an Indian, and then suddenly, you know, you leave Karachi, and then suddenly
there's
Pakistan,
and then like, but, and what does that mean to you?
Exactly.
Right. Yeah. And so what I did meet is like second generation Pakistanis, whose parents, you know, found themselves Pakistani, and they were like, well, what does this really mean to us?
Can I follow up on that?
Very briefly, because I want to ask Dr. Okay. Janardhan.
Well, citizenship and identity is a two-way street. And it's quite interesting. Before 1947, the Indian communities here were, although collectively might have been perhaps perceived as being one group, in reality, they themselves didn't see themselves at all that way. They would say, I'm Kutchi. I'm from Kutch, and I'm from this particular religious community.
Gujarati or right. Sindhi.
And so you have regional identity, you have religious identity, and so these communities were separate. Upon independence in 47, many people in these communities had a real dilemma. If you, for example, were Hindu, but you were from Sindh, then you were on the wrong side of the border.
Because Sindh ended up being in Pakistan.
Right. Okay. So what are you going to do? Right? Are you going to take Pakistani citizenship only to know that eventually it might be taken away and then you go to India, but then you're a traitor, right? To a state that didn't exist at the time. What do you do? So there's an interesting file from Oman just before independence of the British agent in Muscat who was asked to take a poll amongst the Indian community there. What were they going to do upon Indian independence? Turned out, if you were Indian living in Muscat, just before independence, you had four choices. You could take Indian citizenship. If you were from Sindh, you could take Pakistani citizenship. You could take British citizenship or you could take Omani citizenship. And so people made their choices. Some took Omani, some took British, some took Pakistani, some took Indian. But this idea of collective identity is very important because the very concept of India as a unified whole, even the name Hind, comes from the Gulf region. Hind is the old Persian term comes from the old Persian term for the Indus. The Indus is, of course, how we get India from, but it comes to English from the old Persian name for the land of the Indus, Hindustan, right? And the idea of Hindustan was a Gulf, mainly Iranian concept. And here we're talking about going back thousands of years. And the term for the region of India was, you know, Hindustan, right? It started off basically in Sindh and then encompassed Gujarat and then eventually for the entire subcontinent. Now, Indians themselves didn't view themselves this way, nor did Hindus view themselves as a unified collective single community. But the outside perception was strong and over time eventually did result in an all-India movement and then finally an Indian state. So if we go back thousands of years, the Gulf has made a significant contribution to the formation of Indian identity.
Dr. Janardhan, I wanted to go back. I mean, we got great historical context, but I wanted to go back to what Neha said is the fuzzy time period between 1947, 1971. You know, the British withdrew, and and then they withdrew from the Gulf in 1971 or 1970. In this period, the Indian government tried to take control because it was almost lawless. Between the Gulf and between India, the Indian government tried to control the smuggling of gold. They then tried to control the currency situation, and they introduced a currency. I want to ask you a little bit about. Can you tell us about this currency that they introduced, and then I can ask you a little bit about the future trajectory.
I think essentially what happened was the Indian currency was in circulation here as well. Due to smuggling, essentially, yes. India decided at that point that it would be better to have different currencies, one in India and one, you had the Gulf rupee.
But what is the Gulf rupee?
It was a specific currency that was introduced here only for the Gulf.
It was introduced by who?
By the Indian government.
The Indian government introduced it,
yes.
Okay.
Essentially to make a distinction between the Indian rupee and the Gulf rupee.
And
otherwise, in the past, because the circulation, the currency was the same in both places, uh-huh. People brought money here from India physically, converted that into gold, and took it back to India.
Okay.
So India wanted to put an end to that and decided that they would have a different currency for the Gulf, and they introduced the Gulf rupee here. But over a period of time, India also realized that they decided to devalue the Indian rupee, which was not beneficial for the Gulf citizens, essentially.
To make Indian exports cheaper.
That's right.
Okay.
So then the Gulf saw no need to have a Gulf rupee. So they decided that they would introduce their own currency. That's when each of the Gulf countries decided to have their own currency.
And the Indian rupee was being used in the Gulf until when?
Until the 1960s, yeah.
Until the early 70s, that's
yeah.
Right. That's, I think Oman was the last country to...
If you move to your culture aspect,
yes.
You still have pictures in Sharjah,
uh-huh.
Which represent Indians. Actually, when you speak on the cultural aspect, we have people who have migrated from here to Kerala, to Pondicherry, because of the sea route. And we have UAE structures there in Kerala, representing here them. And similarly, we have very ancient cultures here in the UAE also, which resembles much of Indian culture. And when there were marriages happened, everything happened, and we have a special community called the Maplas, who are from the UAE. Till date, we have a UAE community in India, and similarly here. There's been a very good cultural link between India and UAE. And now, when we move towards the strategic partnership, we are looking into more than investments, and many fields.
That's a perfect segue to my question to Dr. Janardhan.
Thanks.
Doctor, we spoke about the historic aspects. I want to talk about the future aspects. As you see, here we have UAE leadership meeting with Indian leadership. There's a new page that's being opened, this strategic ties that they are trying to introduce into this relationship. A Hindu temple is being built now in Abu Dhabi. His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed went as a state guest in the Indian Republic Day, I think, celebrations. What is the significance of this? What does this mean? What does the future look like? Is this a UAE's look east policy?
Essentially, I think both sides, India and the Gulf countries, UAE included, have realized that it can no longer be just a buyer-seller relationship. I mean, trade has been at the bottom of this entire relationship between India and the Gulf, supported by, of course, the people-to-people contacts. But I think time is running out in terms of this just being a buyer-seller relationship. It cannot be a transaction-based relationship alone in the years ahead. That basically emerges from the fact that the security dynamics in the region are changing. We'll come to the security aspects later. But every aspect of the relationship in future would be strategic. Strategic in the term, in the sense that it will not be just left to business people alone to determine what kind of business there would be. It would not be just allowed the people to determine what kind of cultural relationship they would have. There will be a role that the government will play in every sphere. For example, I will just give you some examples on how this strategic partnership will play out in the years ahead. India had never had a strategic energy reserve in the past. But this time, the UAE and India have agreed that there would be a strategic oil reservoir that would be based in India, where UAE would store its oil. 50% of that oil would be used by India in case of emergency, but UAE can store it there for also for its own commercial interests, to sell it and then replenish it at some point in time. That's something new for India and UAE, and that they call that strategic. Just like there is an engagement in terms of the oil partnership, you also have food security that's taking a new form. Traditionally, we've had UAE import what it wants, but now UAE is looking in terms of having some sort of a farm-to-port kind of facility where Indian farms would be allowed to produce, keeping UAE market in mind, and the UAE government would be investing money in those farms. It would be produced there for the local market, and there would be a complete connection from the farm to the port, the entire warehousing facility, the transportation, the logistics, everything would be taken care of.
Is this relationship at the expense of America?
Well, in terms of security, yes. Not entirely at the expense of America, but in future, it would not be an exclusive relationship between the Gulf and the West, the Gulf and America. It would be a much more collective kind of relationship.
Is it a message to a country that's between us?
And, well, it could be, yes. I think there was a lot that was invested in that country which was between us.
Is it a message to the other country between us?
Well, to some extent, there too. It's a message all around. It's a global message.
Is it a message to the country on the other side? Okay, so believe it or not, we only have 9 minutes, and I want to give you guys, do you guys want to ask questions? Or should we just... Anybody has real questions? Okay, I'm giving you guys one chance. There's a gentleman in the front here who has a question. Over here, quickly, please, at the front row. But it has to be very, very brief.
My question is, Dr. Janardhanan, especially if you see the cultural and political relation with this country and India, there is some important aspect. When I landed here in 1970,
you came on a British visa.
Yeah, British
visa. Can you tell us, did you go to a British embassy?
I came with a visa of British, Trucial State Council, and I got stamped in a British consulate in Chennai at that time.
So to come to the UAE,
then
you had to go
I
to the
came
British
to UAE in Dubai. I landed in Dubai, 1970 June. The situation at that time, from safety pins to everything we are sending from UAE to India. Today, the city Karipati to millions of dollar turbine importing to here, in addition to the petrol exporting from here.
Okay, please ask your question.
But my question is this. We had a visit of our prime minister in 1981. Then after that, we had another visit of prime minister 2016. There is a long gap, even though these two countries have a very strong cultural and economic and trade relation.
Excellent question.
What is the reason excellent. Such a gap?
Yes, excellent. So there's almost 30 years. Why weren't there many state visits?
Yeah, I think essentially the two sides took each other for granted. I think trade and people-to-people contacts ensured that everything was in place, everything worked fine enough, and there was no need really for the governments to intervene. But more importantly, I think there was a complete change in mindset in how the two governments began to approach each other. Post-oil, the Gulf countries began to look westwards because for them, they began to associate modernization with westernization. So if they wanted to go about bringing a change in their countries, they wanted to be in the Western style. So they began to look west. Similarly, India had its own issues. I mean, it was a post-colonial country. It had its whole lot of internal problems. It began to look inwards. At the same time, it was busy with what was called the non-aligned movement and not so interested in the Gulf, which was actually taken care of, as I said, by the trade and the business community. But all that began to change post 2000. While the Gulf countries began to look east, essentially after 9/11, India is now looking west. So when you have the Gulf countries looking east and the countries in the east looking west, you're actually now beginning to look at each other. And I think that's the change that has taken place. And if you really want to look at how the entire relationship has been, as if it were good, despite government disengagement, you can imagine how it would prosper with the government interference in the years ahead.
I have a question to Neha that I think would be a bit interesting. There's an issue here in the Gulf that we call the sponsorship system, or the kafala system. Have you guys heard of it? Who hasn't heard of kafala system? Okay, great. There's one person in the back. What are you doing in the UAE? So, in the kafala system, it's a system basically that people have compared to bondage system, to modern day slavery. The Gulf states have gotten a lot of slack by Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International. Why don't they just shake it off? And what is it? Why can't Qatar has promised several times to get rid of it? The other Gulf states are trying, I think. Maybe they're not interested in getting rid of it. What is the kafala system, and how can we shake it off?
Okay, so the kafala system is a decentralized form of migration regulation. It basically means that a citizen or a company sponsors a migrant instead of it being done centrally through the state. Okay, and that means that there's much less oversight, and it also means that in a country like the UAE, where migrants have very few paths to permanence, or none for the most part, there's a very little recourse for them to fight for any kind of labor rights. There have been some reforms in terms of the labor laws in the UAE. However, it still remains incredibly uneven. Some things are illegal, like you're not allowed to hold passports, yet we know that those things still happen. We know that pay still gets withheld. Domestic workers don't fall under the labor laws. They fall under the Ministry of Interior, those kinds of things. So one of the things that I argue in my work is that Indians actually participate in the kafala system. They de facto act as kafils,
okay.
As sponsors. And it is not just a Gulf-based problem. It is something that begins with the sending states that have their own issues in terms of how they perpetuate poverty and how they perpetuate stratification, even though they're technically democratic, right? And these are global processes. And one of the things that I'm looking at in my current research is how, for example, in the United States, we have these new temporary visa regimes that have been happening for about 20 years, like H-1B, right?
Okay.
You guys have heard of H-1B? These are temporary visa regimes that look almost exactly like kafala, where you have body shopping and you have middlemen, usually from your same country of origin, who are exploiting you, and you have very little recourse. And so there's a lot of things that look like kafala happening globally.
So there's been some improvements, but I would like to say, what would you advise these countries to do? When you know, in this case, what would you replace the kafala system with, for example?
Well,
a state system?
I mean, I'm not a pundit, so I have a very hard time making those kinds of pronouncements. But what I would say is that we need to look at this as a larger global problem, mm-hmm. of global flows of capital and how citizenship is becoming delinked from rights.
Mm-hmm.
And rights are becoming more about economic access and how migration and mobility is becoming more about being temporary and not having access to forms of official belonging and official rights in the host country. So I would say that if we want to dismantle kafala, we don't just blame it on the country of the
but
host
receive.
Country. We need to look at a much larger problem, and we need to de-exceptionalize the Gulf and think about how these things are patterns that happen in many parts of the world.
We need to de-exceptionalize the Gulf. I just want to ask the guys 5 minutes, but I want to give maybe the final comment to you, James. I want to ask you about continuity. What are the remnants? What stayed from the time of the British era? And what do you see continues? And what should we maybe look back to? Mm. Maybe what should we keep from the past? And what should we change going forward?
Well, there's a mix of continuity and discontinuity. So some of the old communities that were here before Indian independence in 1947 are still here. But the vast majority of the diaspora that's in the Gulf now from India or South Asia more broadly is new. They're from new parts of the subcontinent, new communities. And that is because of oil, huge influx of people. So that has created amongst the Indian communities here a lot of change. Other things is that India's legacy here, cultural legacy, material cultural legacy, has largely gone almost invisible. But if you know what to look for, it's everywhere around you. And you realize just how incorporated, heavily incorporated, Indian material culture, representing as it being here because of trade, is all around us. You made a reference to Kashmiri shawls that are worn by most Khaliji men in winter. You go to the heritage districts in Dubai, right, or in any of the Gulf states, and you'll see the old buildings with the large door. That door is from India. It was shipped out from, it was carved in India by an Indian carpenter, but shipped out on a dhow as ballast. We see, for example, if you look into a museum, you'll see the Emirati chest or Kuwaiti chest, these chests that were used by many people, but are a sign of wealth, but also, you know, to keep family heirlooms in and so on like that. Well, the adjective applies to the owner, not to the maker. These Indian chests were, these were actually Indian chests, mm-hmm. made of Indian wood, usually by Indian craftsmen. So the link with India, in fact, is very old, not new. And this returning of links is actually a return to the normal state of relations. It's been a very prosperous historically relationship, a crucial one for the Gulf. Now we're getting back to recognizing that, I think officially, that India and South Asia more broadly is the Gulf's natural most important business partner, trading partner.
Dr. Janardhan, just a yes or no question, sorry for this. We saw the UAE allow visa on arrival for Russians, visa on arrival for Chinese. Do you see a day when there's going to be visa on arrival for Indians coming to the Gulf or Emiratis going to India?
Well, one way, yes,
optimistic,
not the other
note.
Way. It would be a one-way traffic.
Maybe a bit more optimistic. Okay.
No, certainly not.
Certainly not. How? Can we have 10 more minutes? Okay, I have to close this panel. So interesting, but James Onley, Neha Vora, Professor Janardhan, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you.